Good morning. Welcome to Parks Church. Glad to see everybody this morning. If you'll grab whatever you need, coffee or whatever it might be, and find a seat, we'll go ahead and get started. My name is Eric. I'm one of the pastors here at Parks Church. Glad to see you, especially if you're visiting with us this morning. I want to say a special welcome to you. A couple of things you can do to help us out if you are visiting, and if you want to keep up with things that are going on in the church, you can download our app, Parks Church PCA app, and follow along there with updates,
or a better way might be to fill out a connect card
so that we can put you on our email list, or let you know things that are going on in the church community, and follow up with you with any questions you might have.
Those can be found at the information desk, or you can just tell one of us after the service, and we'll get you on that list.
A couple of announcements before we get started this morning. We do have a 9 o'clock Sunday class that's been going for the last 3 weeks. We've got our last class of the first four-week session. And then after fall break, we'll start up a new class. There'll be some information about that coming up. But they're standalone. You don't have to have come to the last three to come to the last one next week. We wanted to let you know about that. It's right behind me down the hallway in the library at 9 o'clock on Sundays. And then there's home groups that are going on. Small groups that meet in people's homes to fellowship together, to know each other, to care for one another. Usually around some sort of discussion of God's word or prayer, sharing prayer requests. So if you're not involved in one of those, want to connect deep more deeply to the Parks Church family. We'd love for you to do that. There's information about that on the blackboard in the back, or you can ask somebody like Joe at the information desk. We'll follow up with that. And the last thing is, if you are new or coming and are interested in learning more about the church, possibly even about becoming a member, we're going to start today at lunch at the Ashley home after the service. We're going to order some food and discuss and chat about kind of the story of how Parks came into being, and begin that kind of process. There'll be three meetings, either in person or online. I'll send you some materials to read, and then we'll meet and discuss it for a few minutes. That's going on. Some of you are planning on coming. If some of you showed up and didn't know about that but want to join us, we'd love to have you. Just come talk to me or to my wife Annette after the service, and we'll get you directions. We're right behind Bobby's Dairy Dip off of Charlotte Avenue, so we'd love for you to come for that. We're going to meet outside and enjoy time together. I think that's it. We are joined today by some students from Belmont and interns for Belmont RUF. Let me tell you real quick what RUF means, because when you speak that into your phone, I found out it actually spells out R-A-R-E-U-Y-O-U, but it means Reformed University Fellowship. So it's a campus ministry that actually the Lord used mightily in my own life, in my own time in college, that seeks to minister to college students, to reach and equip college students for Jesus is their mission statement. So Etta and Jonathan and some others work as intern staff, and these are some students that are helping them out with worship this morning, so we're glad to have them. Let me direct your attention to the screen to prepare your hearts for worship with a reflection that gets our hearts ready to talk about, to hear about, to consider rest this morning. Let's stand together as we greet God and one another using the words on the screen. The Lord be with you. God is our refuge and strength. The Lord Almighty is with us. God, we thank you for that truth, that you are near, that you're with us today. And God, would you make that real to us? Would we run to you and see you and seek you as our refuge and strength today? We pray it in Jesus' strong name. Amen. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
God calls us to confession, a time of confession. This morning we're using Matthew 11. It says this, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." We're going to be talking from Hebrews today about the concept, the idea of rest, of even what it is and how we enter the rest that he offers in Jesus. And so it's appropriate to spend some time in confession today along some of those lines of ways that we tend to secure that ourselves. We tend to put the burden on our own shoulders and do it ourselves instead of rolling that burden onto him, finding the peace that passes all understanding that guards our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So let's do that now. Let's lay ourselves before the Lord in dependence upon him as we confess our sin using this prayer that we'll pray together. Let's pray now. Father in heaven, we need to be forgiven. We have tried to heal ourselves. Instead of trusting in the death of Jesus Christ, we have tried to work off our guilt. We have tried so hard to pile up good deeds that outweigh our sins. When this doesn't work, we quickly turn to denial and distraction. Instead of trusting in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we have tried to change through our own efforts. We have tried to change our hearts through sheer willpower. This has left some of us arrogant. This has left most of us anxious, depressed, and weary. Forgive us for trying to heal ourselves. Forgive us for neglecting your grace. Grant us the deep rest and freedom purchased and provided by Jesus. We ask in his name. Amen. Now we're going to sing a song of confession. It may be a new song to some of you. If it is, then just wait until you get the gist of it. But use it as your heart's prayer. You can stay seated as we sing.
The Lord that I might grow in faith and love and every grace, might more of his salvation know and seek more earnestly his face. This he who taught me thus to pray, I trust has answered prayer, but it has been in such a way as almost drove me to despair. Some I trembling cry. Wilt thou pursue thy worm to death? 'Tis in this way the Lord replied. I answer prayer for grace and faith. These inward trials
honesty of that song, how it feels sometimes the Lord's killing us when he's doing his best work to open up our hearts so that he can heal us. The good news is that as he does expose our sin, his grace is greater than all of our sin, and it meets us, and it does provide the healing that we do so desperately need. Peter knew that. Peter was exposed in denying Jesus three times, right at his moments of greatest need. And then the risen Christ meets Peter on the beach after cooking some fish for him, and he restores him. And just like Peter denied three times, Jesus asked him three times, Peter, do you love me? And in doing so, restored him. Peter knew that, and it was that led him to say later on this word from Acts 3. Peter says, I have no silver or gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Peter went from one who was boasting of his own feats to one who was desperately dependent upon the Lord and says, I don't have anything of myself to give you but Jesus. And that's all that you and I need. That's the gospel. That's the good news. We have in him all that we need. Let's stand together and respond to that using these words on the screen. Brothers and sisters, lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Cast away for life to
God, we're thankful for that truth, that as we trust in you, as we rest in you, in your record, in your merits, not our own, that we can be sure that we have a promised land, a land of rest to enter into. And that may that truth warm our hearts today as we worship in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Kiddos that are headed to your lesson can come gather up front and line up. We'll pray for you and for us, for our time in God's Word. All right. Got a good crew. Can we bow our heads and pray for time in the Word? God, thank you for these little ones. Thank you that you tell us to come like them to you, eager to receive from your word, and pray that they would do that and that we would do that even now, that you would be our teacher. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As they make their way out, take just a moment to greet some around you or grab some coffee or whatever you need before we head to a time of God's word.
Okay, cool. I'll hold it low. Yeah. Thank you.
Back and find a seat. We'll go ahead. All right, if you will find a seat, we'll go ahead and get started. Actually, find a seat and then let's stand in honor of the reading of God's word.
In Hebrews 3:12-15, take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart, leading you to fall away from the living God. But exhort one another every day, as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original confidence firm to the end. As it is said, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. The word of the Lord.
So if you do have Bibles, you can turn to Hebrews and keep it there, because we're going to be looking back and forth with some passages before and after the one we just read. We're really going to be looking at the whole kind of trajectory of chapters 3 and 4 today as we spend time in God's Word. So you can keep your thumb there, and we'll reference several different passages there. Could you imagine with me for just a minute as we get started? Turn your imaginative juices on for just a moment. Just imagine it's fall, right? First day of fall was this week, and imagine you were getting up this morning, you looked out the window, and it was foggy, and you thought, I might need a little windbreaker, a little jacket. It's in the attic. I'm going to go up there and grab it. And so you make your way to the attic, you flip on the lights, you find the box, you pull out your winter clothes, you find your windbreaker. And as you turn around, you bump a box, and out of the box falls out this golden lamp. Right? You know where I'm going? Pick up the golden lamp, and you trying to rub it off to see what the markings there are, and out of the lamp comes, lo and behold, a genie. Right? And the genie says to you what? You have 3 wishes. And then this genie's nice, so it's trying to help you out with your wishes. So he or she says to you, think really long and hard, because if you do this right, you can do a wish that actually takes care of a lot of the other wishes that you would make that were more surface level. So try to go deep. Try to use your 3 wishes to get the heart and the root of it all that takes care of maybe a lot of the other concerns in your life. What would you wish for? You don't have to tell me. But would think about that. So what would you wish for? What would be the three things that would say, man, these three things, if I had these three things, it would take care of all of these other desires and needs and wants in my life? As you think about that, ask yourself the added question of, would rest make the list? Would one of the three things that you wished for, three of the biggest needs, the root needs of your life, be rest? We're going to talk about that this morning. We're going to unpack the one statement that I think summarizes chapters 3 and 4 of Hebrews, which is, you and I need a deep rest that only Jesus can provide. You and I need a deep rest that only Jesus can provide. So those are the three points today, right? You and I need a deep rest. We're going to look, secondly, at that we are in significant danger of missing out on that rest. And then finally, we're going to end up with only Jesus can provide the rest we need. Simple outline, but hopefully we'll find some profound truths for the application of our lives. So let's start together. You and I need a deep rest. You and I need a deep rest. This passage that Edda read is smack dab in the middle of a bigger passage that talks about it. It is asking the original audience to put themselves back in the shoes of the people that were on Exodus from the land of Egypt going into what we just sung about, the promised land. And so they're asked to do that. And so let's do the same thing. Let's put ourselves in the shoes of the Exodus generation. Do you remember what happened with them? They've been 400 years in slavery, right? Generational slavery. Almost forgetting who they were and losing their identity in a foreign land with a foreign king. And God miraculously draws them out. And yet, it was one of those situations that it wasn't all just, you know, smooth going. It actually was the opposite. They were called out of the land of Egypt, which had been the land of slavery, but they were to journey towards a land of rest, a land flowing with milk and honey. But you read the passages in Exodus and the books that follow that tell about that journey, and it's pretty mind-blowing. I mean, they would set up their tents in the desert. We're talking about millions of people here. Setting up their tents in the desert. And here's how it would work. You would, I don't know if you've ever been camping, but you would set up your tent. You would get your family all settled. You'd put your livestock or your camels or whatever you have, get them fed and watered. You'd fix food for the evening. You'd finally settle down for you know, the nighttime. And basically, you were looking towards this pillar of fire at night to give you light and warmth, which was the presence of God, and the pillar of cloud in the day to provide shade and guidance. The issue was, whenever that pillar of fire or cloud started moving, it was time for you to pack up camp and get moving. And whenever it settled, you were to settle. So imagine setting up all of your stuff, and just as you start to get the kids down for bed, the pillar starts moving. And you're like, oh no, we got to get everything back up, pack up the camels, get everything. If you've ever packed for a trip, you can imagine what that's like. You pack everything up, and you're on the go again. And then you settle, and you're like, this time I'm not going to be fooled. I'm not going to pack everything. And we're just going to rough it tonight. And then a day goes by. And another day goes by. And another day goes by. And then you say, you know what, let's set everything out. Let's get it set up. Looks like we're going to be here for a while. And just as you get everything set up, it starts moving again, right? That's the kind of life, the nomadic pilgrimage lifestyle they led, depending upon the Lord, but in a very difficult journey leading up to the promised land. And what they were looking forward to was a deep rest, a rest from the hardship of that pilgrimage, a rest from the hostility that they faced in Egypt and the slavery that they were a part of, a rest from the insecurity and the instability of a life led so in such dependence upon this God who they followed. The Hebrew recipients of this sermon, as it was read, were experiencing something similar. It wasn't an Exodus generation, but they knew and could identify a lot with that generation because they were living with the fear of death, of uncertainty, of life outside of their control. Actually, the reason this sermon was written down and sent is because this pastor friend of theirs knew what they were going through and knew they were wavering in their faith. They were having a hard time holding on to it. And so he rewrites this saying, listen, you know that you're longing for this rest from fear, this rest from uncertainty, this rest from being out of control and this wavering faith. And then add on top of that, one more layer, this passage speaks of in the beginning verses of chapter 4, the fact that God himself instituted rest. So it's saying, yes, rest is a rest from the hardship of life and from fear and uncertainty and instability and all of those things. But actually, God's rest, the rest that God really wants for you, is much more than a ceasing from, a rescue from all of these hard things. But it's also a celebration, a celebrating of and an enjoying of the gifts of God. The way it speaks of God is almost like a craftsman that has done his work, and it's been a hard labor, but he now gets to sit back and enjoy the fruits of his labor. The enjoyment of the completion of the work that he's done. That's what it talks about God in the works of creation that it references here in this passage. It says the rest that he's talking about here is a rest from. You can look back to the Exodus generation and think of what they went through. You can look, Hebrews, at the difficulties that you're going through. We, all these years later, can look at all the difficulties of our lives and think, man, real rest would be a rest from all of those things. But it's also a reminder that it's a rest unto, enjoyment, a completion, a satisfaction. When I was growing up, there were Old Milwaukee commercials. And there were, I don't know why beer companies always have the best commercials. They must pay a ton for marketing. But Old Milwaukee commercials was always a group of usually guys sitting around a fire with their Old Milwaukee. And you know, they'd just done some, you know, fishing or hunting or whatever it might be. And they're looking at each other. And one of them looks at the other. And what does he say? It just doesn't get any better than this. Right? There's a sense there of it doesn't get any better than this. Now, what it doesn't show, right, in those commercials, is the mosquitoes that are biting them as they're around the campfire. And the fact that they just, you know, probably lost their tempers with each other while they were setting up their tents for camping. And the life that they're about to go back to, which is full of stress, and the internal struggles and relational conflicts that they're all carrying with them out there in that wilderness, right? The sense of it doesn't get any better than this is not actually a true picture, even in that commercial, but it helps to sell their beer, right? And yet, there's something there that resonates with us. There's something of that picture that says, okay, and there's something deeper there that says, yes, there's a freedom from and an enjoyment of. And the reason that resonates with us is because it's God-given, placed inside of us. That's what we were made for. Is an enjoyment of God and one another and the works, the fruits of our labors. When is the last time you felt really rested? When is the last time you felt truly rested? What would I even feel like? Have you forgotten? What would you do? What would you give in order to gain that right now in your own life? Jesus says you can have it. Jesus says you can have real, true, deep rest. But before we get to that, let's look at point two, which the passage draws out that we are in significant danger of actually missing out on that rest. We're in significant danger of missing out on that rest. There's a warning here right at the heart of the passage that Etta read. And it's over and over throughout the other passage. It says, take care, brothers. And that brothers there is brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters, lest there be any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God. But exhort one another every day, as long as it's called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we've come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our confidence firm to the end. As it said, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. Verse 8 of chapter 3 says, do not harden your hearts. Verse 15 says, do not harden your hearts. Verse 7 of chapter 4 says, do not harden your hearts. You think he wants us to hear that? He repeats it three times. He also repeats the other phrase that comes along with it in verse 11, they shall not enter my rest. In verse 3 of chapter 4, they shall not enter my rest. In verse 4 of chapter 3, they shall not enter my rest. Those two are tied together. Do not harden your hearts, or you shall not enter my rest. What does he say? He's sounding the alarm, the warning. There is a rest, and you need it, he's saying. but you will not enter it if you have a hard heart, if your heart has been hardened. Now, what in the world does he mean there? What does it mean to have a hard heart that leads us to that danger of not entering the rest that is offered and provided? Well, the meaning there, again, goes back to the Exodus generation. Scholars think that the writer of this sermon was spending a lot of devotional time in two passages, and he quotes them a lot here. One of them is Psalm 95, and then Numbers 14. So Psalm 95 and Numbers 14, two significant Old Testament passages, and he sees in them this intricate link. If you go back and read them, you can see the link, and it's almost like Psalm 95 asks the hard questions, and Numbers 14 answers the hard questions. And so there's a dialogue, an interplay that goes back and forth here. And what he's alluding to is the rebellion, which we heard about and read about in the passage. The rebellion, what is he talking about? Well, as the people were rescued from slavery and journeyed to the promised land, they got right up to the edge of it. And what they did was they sent out spies to spy out the land. And the spies came back, Joshua and Caleb, they came back along with a bunch of other spies, and they gave a report. And the report was this: God wasn't joking. The land is amazing. It's filled with milk and honey, but let me tell you what else it's filled with. And they talked about the fortified cities. They talked about the giants that walked among them. They talked about the impossibility of their insignificant nation actually doing what God called them to do, to enter into this land and rest. There's no way. And Joshua and Caleb warned them, reminded them of, no, we serve a living God who promised this. Why wouldn't we follow him? But they ignored the promise in what we would know of as contempt, refusing to believe God, choosing to listen to human voices of despair rather than to the voice of the Almighty God who had rescued them. That's what he's talking about here when he talks about hardening your hearts. He's saying the way that they hardened their hearts is actually the danger that all of us are on the verge of hardening our hearts, of refusing to believe, of choosing to listen to human voices of despair rather than to the voice of God, of actually holding God in contempt. What we all wrestle with is what they wrestled with. When we're faced with something that seems outside of our control, that we feel unstable, that we don't have the resources to do, the tendency, instead of following through and relying on the resources of the Almighty God who gives us his promises, instead of relying on that, we tend to rely on our own strength. And in doing so, those things seem impossible. Those things seem like we'd be foolish to pursue because those things are too hard for us. And what happens is we harden or we cover over or we toughen, or we seal, or we close off our hearts to God in whatever area that is. Now, I'm not wanting to minimize the difficulties we go through. Listen, when you get betrayed by somebody, when someone takes intimate knowledge that you've told them and uses it against you, and that happens over and over again, there are boundaries that probably need to be set with that person. But the tendency for us is not just to set boundaries, but to close off our hearts. I've been hurt. I'll never be hurt like that again. And so we close off our heart, and in doing so, we close out the work that God might do. It takes the shape of anxiety and worry. It takes the shape of anxiety and worry. A couple of things just to say about that. Worry and anxiety reveals what we value. Worry and anxiety reveals what we value. Do we value the things of the world, or do we value Jesus? We get in this passage a little bit of a preview of what's to come in the latter parts of the sermon. In Hebrews 10, there's an amazing passage that the preacher talks about the people that were an example to all of us. And it says of them, it says that they were walking towards, like the picture is almost of a movie, of them walking towards ministering to those people in prison while behind them their houses are being burned. The persecution is that severe for them. That they are leaving behind all of their belongings and material possessions in order to go minister to someone else, and it says they did it with joy. And you're like, what in the world? How do people do that? How do people have joy to go minister to somebody when their possessions are being burned? Because they value something other or greater than the possessions that they're leaving behind. They found a deeper satisfaction, a deeper joy in Jesus and the work that he's called them to. What we worry about, what consumes our thoughts, is what we value. Secondly, what we worry about, what causes our anxiety, reflects our view of God. I read a quote this week. Actually, Scotty Smith sent me a quote from Tim Keller. It said this: worry is thinking God will not get this right. Worry is thinking God will not get this right. And he went a step further and said bitterness is believing God got it wrong. So our anxiety, our worry is, God, in this area, I give you all these other things, but in this area, I don't think you're going to get it right. You've proven whatever in the background and in the backdrop of my life that I can't trust you here. And then bitterness is holding on to that thing that God didn't come through in the way that you or I thought he would, and holding it against him. So it reflects your view of God, and it relates to your trust in God. God will give you X and Y, but not Z, not this. I'm holding on to this. I am hardening, toughening, sealing off, closing off my heart to you in this area. That's what he's talking about with hardness of heart. With hardness of heart, what happens is our anxiety and our worry produces in us self-protection and hardening, clenching tight, closing off certain areas to anybody else, including God. You can't get in here. And what that produces in us is restlessness. When we have to bear that burden ourselves, when we put it on our own shoulders, what God says is that's going to absolutely wear you out. It's going to wear you down. It's going to cause discouragement. It's going to cause despair and all of those things. That will not lead to rest. You're hardening your hearts, and so you will not taste the rest that I have to offer. 2 Corinthians 4 is a vivid picture of what God uses, how God uses our difficulties, our sufferings. When it talks about that the sufferings that we're presently experiencing are not worth comparing to the glories that are ahead. And it says even, it uses the language that God is even using our sufferings to prepare us for, or to prepare for us, it could be either way, and both apply, for the weight of glory that's coming. The idea, the picture there is of a stretching, of a molding, of a widening and a broadening, of to be able to contain, to hold more and more and more of God's glory. He's saying, you're too small now. You can only just get a taste of it. Let me stretch you. Let me mold you. Again, it's that keeping us moldable so as to stretch us to hold more and more of his glory. The Exodus generation, we're on the verge of the promised land. They were about to enter in and taste his fullness that he had promised. But instead of trusting him, they rebelled. They were so close, but they settled for a Dixie cup instead of able to drink deeply of the fullness of the rest that God provides. And the warning to us and to these original hearers is don't be like them. Don't do the same thing today in the middle of your difficulty. And so we need to ask today, are our hearts hardened in any area? Do we display an attitude of unbelief? Do we have a disposition of grumbling and complaining about our circumstances, of seeing our circumstances and then grumbling and complaining against God, rather than getting a clear view of the beauty and glory of God and then trying to make sense of the circumstances in which we find ourselves? Those are two very, very different things. So what's the answer? You and I need this deep rest, but we are constantly and always in significant danger of missing out on that rest because of our own hardening of our hearts. Well, the answer is the Sunday school answer. It's Jesus. But that is a simple answer, but it's not simplistic. Not ever. Because when you say the answer is Jesus, you're saying a whole lot. That only Jesus can provide the rest we need. There's two things here in this passage, two pictures that he gives us that shows that Jesus can provide the rest we need. One is that he's a better Moses. He's a better Moses. You see that in the opening verses of chapter 3 where he compares Jesus to Moses. And I won't give you all the details, but basically what he ends up saying is Moses was faithful. He was the greatest of all prophets. He has this unbelievable place in the the history of the nation of Israel. But then he says, as great as he was, he didn't come close to Jesus. He was the house while Jesus was the builder. He was the servant while Jesus was the son. He was focused on the material rest of all the things we just talked about. Jesus is bringing an internal rest that's beyond all comprehension. And so he talks about how Jesus is better. We talked about last week, but Jesus knows us. He deeply identified us more than anybody could. And then he went on our behalf to gain this rest that we so long for and so need. So first of all, he's a better Moses. And secondly, this is a little bit hidden, but he is a better word. He's a better word. Again, a preview of what's to come in this passage. In the last few verses of chapter 4, in verses 11 through 13, he talks about, let us strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, discerning the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. No creature is hidden from his sight. All are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. What in the world is he talking about? Why that? Why a for the word of God is living and active? Why does he connect that there for us? Well, to find the answer, if you look ahead to Hebrews 11 and 12, you see another two-edged sword talked about and another word talked about. And it references Abel. Remember the story of Abel, Cain and Abel? Early on in the Bible, after sin had entered the world through the rebellion of Adam and Eve, one of the first clearest acts of sin and rebellion, of the outworking of sin that was in man's heart, was the killing of Abel by his brother Cain. And it's violent. It's Abel offered the sacrifice in faith. Cain did not. God accepted Abel's. We don't even know all the reasons why, but he accepted Abel's because it was given in faith, and he did not. Cain gets mad, and he finds an opportunity, and he kills his brother Abel. He uses, either metaphorically or literally, a two-edged sword. And he kills his brother Abel. And it says in Hebrews chapter 11 that his blood speaks to us, cries out to us from the ground. What is it talking about? It's saying, hey, that story is still told. That blood of the consequences of sin, the devastation of sin, how it works itself out in our hearts and lives in the worst possible way, still speaks to us and reminds us that we're in a world that doesn't work the way it's supposed to. It's filled with sin. It infects the world and our own hearts. It taints every part of our faculties. It's not as bad as it could be, thank goodness, because of the restraining grace of Jesus, but it still infects everything. And that blood cries out and reminds us, yes, we're not home. We're not there yet. And it doesn't leave us there. It says, as loud of a word as that still speaks to us, from all the way back in the first chapters of Genesis, Jesus' blood speaks a greater word. Jesus' blood speaks a greater word. His blood speaks of one who took our place, who remedied the problem of sin. Not just so that we can go be with him one day, although that would be enough, but also so that the curse of sin will be reversed and his blessing will go as far as the curse is found, that heaven will come to earth, that everything will be made new. The song that we just sang about, that's where we're headed, to this eternal rest where heaven joins earth and everything is made new. Abel received a wound of a sin-sick world that led to death. When Jesus wounds us, it's the wound of a loving Savior that breaks through hard hearts and leads to life. It's the scalpel of a surgeon, not the knife of a murderer. In C.S. Lewis's book, The Great Divorce, there's pictures of that, where these ghost-like people who are only shadows of their true selves are given a chance to come to heaven, the heavenly country, and stay. And every heavenly being that meets them tries to persuade them to come further up and further in, to leave whatever it is they're hanging on to, and instead take Jesus and stay in the land of rest, that is right before them. And in one interaction, the guy that's watching on, that's writing the story, asks one of the heavenly beings that he's walking with, he says, will that person be able to stay? And he says, well, it depends. If there is an ember, the heavenly being tells him, if there's an ember left that is just even the remote, have the remote of a spark to it, then it will be fanned into a flame. It will be fanned into a flame. That's what the Word of God does to us. When we come to it, it is living and active. It's sharper than a two-edged sword that if you've ever been cut, you don't even realize it sometimes until you're bleeding. It's that sharp. Without even knowing it, we read it, but it reads us, and it slices through those hard hearts and peels away those layers that we have built upon it so that it can begin to minister to us the grace of Jesus, the better word that has been spoken, the word that leads to life. A lot of the times, it feels like Jesus is killing us. He's actually saving us. He's doing the heart surgery that we need as we come to him in his word. And that's when rest happens. When we don't understand, but we come to one who has never been confused or surprised. When we feel like we're in the middle of a mystery, but we come to one who knows no mystery. When we come with our rule and certainty being weak to one whose rule is always certain and is never weakened or defeated. When we come as people who are unstable to one who is the firm foundation. When we come to people who are filled with fear to the one who is perfect love that drives out fear. We stop trying to load our own shoulders and do it ourselves, and we come to Jesus and roll our burden onto him and find in him the rest that we need. Let me end with this. My grandmother had Alzheimer's, and you know, slowly lost her memories. And you know, you can get an experience, a taste of that sometimes in your own life, and the scariness that it must be to walk that road of that awful disease. But there are times, you know, I'm 44. Is that right? 44. Yeah, I'm 44, and there are times, like just now, that I forget. I lose my memory. There'll be things that I was going to do. I walked into the kitchen to do this thing. Now, why was I in here? Or, man, I can't forget this, and there was something I was going to tell you, and I can't quite get it. Or you lose something, and what do? You start to retrace your steps. Let me remember, where was I, and what did I do then? And there'll be a moment in the midst of all that fog, there'll be a moment of clarity, right? But, oh, yeah, I remember what it was. Oh, yeah, I remember where I put those keys, or whatever it is. I remember going to visit my grandmother when she was, during her last couple of years, and I remember walking around the corner. We went as a family to visit her, and she was sitting on a couch with some of her friends in the home that she was in, and we rounded the corner, and she looked up, and for an instant, her face lit up, and she had a moment of recognition. And then her face kind of glazed over, and she went back to the state that she was in. But it was that moment of clarity, that moment of remembrance. I want to ask her one day when I get to heaven, like, did you recognize us for just a second? Yeah. There's a verse here that we can just gloss over and it's hidden. But it is God's secret. It's God's secret weapon. It's his gift that he's given us, a tool to help us remember, to have moments of clarity in the midst of the fog and the haze that we live in. And that moment, it's found in right there in verse 13, where in the middle of all this desire for rest and not having it and hardening of our hearts, he says, but exhort one another every day as long as it's called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Exhort one another. Encourage one another. I even love that word, encourage one another. God has given us a tool for clarity, and it's through encouragement. It's through exhortation, which literally means a strong urging or appeal. And that's where I want to leave us today, is to say, hey, let's take up that tool this week. I need it. And my guess is that you do too, that we are longing for rest, and what we need is a word from our brother and sister. It is a strong urging, a shaking, if you will, to bring us that moments of clarity of like, oh yeah, Don't run for those other things. Run to Jesus for rest. So here's your homework. Write a note or three. Write an email, send a text, or better yet, have a phone call or a coffee with someone and give them one or two high-octane truths of the gospel that will urge them to look away from the things that they might be trusting in and look again to Jesus and to find in him the rest that we so long for. Let's pray this morning. God, we need that. We need you. Give us that kind of rest, not just from, although we need that, we need rest from all of the things that we're struggling with and wrestling through, but also give us the enjoyment of you, the taste of what's to come, a foretaste of the feasting and the celebration that will come when that the work is complete. May we be bearers of that word to each other through encouragement this week to remind each other of the truths of the gospel, the beauty of you, Jesus, so that we can have moments of clarity amidst the confusion and we can long for and look to the rest that only you can provide. Give us that rest. Stretch us and make us bigger containers to hold your glory and to be satisfied and sustained through it. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This time we'll respond to the teaching of God's word through giving of our offerings and our tithes as the guys pass the baskets in just a minute, but also our hearts as we sing these words. We pick out these songs every week to place the words that we need to say back to God that our hearts need to feel and to shape how we feel about God. So let's respond in those two ways this morning. Because of the generous riches of our inheritance in Jesus, we now freely give the offerings of our hearts to you.
Faithful one.
Y'all can be seated. Let's pray together. Father, we praise you for who you are. We praise you for your goodness and your power and your love for us. And we thank you for the chance to worship you and hear your word preached this morning and to praise you with song, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that Hebrews tells us that we have a great high priest in Jesus who allows us to come boldly to your throne of grace and to receive help in time of need. So, Lord, we come to you with our needs this morning. We're weak people, and we need you. And we lift up all of those in our congregation, Lord, who are hurting, who've lost friends or loved ones, who have undergone just difficult circumstances in life, Lord. We pray that you would draw near and comfort those who are mourning, Lord, and help those who are facing fears and anxieties of all kinds from life's difficulties to turn to you and to trust you and to know that you're good and that you care for us. Lord, we also want to lift up two families in our congregation specifically this morning. Father, we pray for Drew and Allie Bloodworth. We ask for continued good health for Allie and her baby, and we thank you for protecting them so far during this pregnancy. We also pray that you would equip Drew and Allie with everything that they need for parenthood, Lord. And Lord, we also lift up Sam and Kate Grayson. We thank you for the joy and the life that they bring to this church. We pray that you would strengthen and protect their marriage. We ask that you'd help them to extend Jesus in all the places that you have put them, Lord. And we pray that you would bless Sam's work, Lord, and bless everything that he puts his hands to, God. Thank you again, Lord, for the chance to worship you this morning. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, let's stand. It's been a sweet morning of worship. Stretch forth your hands to receive the blessing of God. May the amazing grace of the Master Jesus Christ, the extravagant love of God the Father, and the intimate friendship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Praise God.